This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, the city of Memphis braces itself for a mass layoff, and the Mid-South mourns the loss of Bishop J.O. Patterson, Jr. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, and Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer.
Welcome to Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Thanks for joining us. Les Smith and Jackson Baker are both on assignment this week, but Andy Meek from the Memphis Daily News has joined us to fill in. Thanks for being here.
Welcome.
We start with you, Amos, and layoffs at the city. This was part of the budget deal that balanced the budget just a week ago. There was a tax hike on the one hand, but a whole lot of cuts on the other. But now we have a little bit more detail about the numbers of people who are going to be losing their jobs. Tell us about it.
That's correct. The administration of Mayor Warden has included 125 layoffs in this budget. This has been there from the beginning. It was a cost reduction measure. If you're going to save any kind of money in city government or any government really, it's going to have to come from personnel, where most of your money goes. So up to 125 employees are going to lose their jobs today, Friday. That number may go down a little bit as some senior employees take voluntary retirement, which would essentially save another person's job, and as they make other budget changes and finalizations. But it will be, people will lose their jobs.
One of the things people talk about is, no one likes to see anyone lose their job, mm-hmm. but the private sector, certainly over the last 2 years, has a tremendous number of layoffs, cutbacks, salary reductions, and so on. And so there are people who would certainly say this was maybe overdue, that city government in general needed to take the same medicine that some of the businesses around town, around the country have also taken.
City officials, even Mayor Wharton himself, has said that, is basically that the city was kind of on cruise control, I guess, in the latter years of the Harrington administration. And now he's here to kind of pick up the pieces and deal with it in the best way they can.
Bill, you've covered City Hall a long time. Other times when there have been cutbacks of this size, of 100-plus people, do they tend to cut top positions? Are we going to see, big-name people laid off, or is it really going to be more the staff and the people behind the scenes that they cut?
It will be more of the people who are on the staff, the middle positions, although you could see some people at the top go. Wharton has still not ruled out a combination of three divisions in particular: park services, public service, and neighborhoods, and the third would be
community enhancement.
Yeah.
So you might see some consolidation of that down the road. It's also important to point out that when you talk about cutting the city's payroll, there are jobs that have actual people in them, and then there are positions that remain in the budget
right.
but have not been filled, and an even larger number of positions that haven't been filled will be eliminated.
And also, correct me if I'm wrong, Amos, across the board, there's a 4% cut, basically the equivalent of taking out 13 to 14 paid
right.
holidays. Is that right?
That's right. They reduced it from 13 days down to 1 day. That equaled a 4.6% reduction
okay.
in salary. And that's the way they decided to go at it. They decided to make a 4.6 reduction over the course of the year. They seem to believe that some employees would get hit really hard by missing, say, 1 or 2 days pay on a paycheck, so they wanted to spread it out over the course of the year.
And let's talk beyond the there's something emotional about people getting laid off that, it's kind of hard to watch. Other things that are cut as part of this budget are services, and we were talking some of the services, big and small, that will be cut back over this budget year. Talk about those.
You'll see, parks and medians, they'll be mowed. It'll be a lot longer in between those mowing times than it is currently. So you'll start to see the grass and the weeds in the medians and in the parks, which that always frustrates people. That's the last time we really had this happen was 6 years ago. That was what, you know, really grabbed people's attention. So that's going to, we'll see that go. I think that'll be one of the, you know, the biggest challenges and what city officials will hear most of the complaints about.
And then the library, you said hours are getting cut back.
Right. Temporary employees, a lot of their temporary employees, the funding was not provided in this year's budget. So libraries will see reductions in hours, probably 1 hour each day.
All right. Well, we will, and also some changes to the pension reform, that's coming up. We'll cover that as we get more details, but that's certainly a big component of reducing
costs.
That'll
have to get through the council, too.
Okay. We move on to some good news, we think, on the economic front, and turn to you, Andy. Kruger, a manufacturer of paper goods of a whole range of sorts and sizes, based in Memphis, has gotten a tax incentive package from the city county to expand their plant here dramatically. Tell us a little bit about where that stands and what it involves.
Right. It's a Canadian manufacturer that has an operation here in Memphis. And certainly we go from the loss of a lot of jobs that Amos was talking about to potentially adding something like 100 jobs at this location in Memphis. They already have close to 300 here. A quick recap of the news this week is local economic officials approved a 15-year tax freeze to entice this expansion and investment in the Memphis operation. It'll save something like $45 million in taxes to get this thing done. So it's a big benefit to get them here. They are a paper goods manufacturer, $300 million investment they're talking about. They're sort of looking around at all their network now. And it's almost becoming a recurring theme that we're talking about on this show, right? An international company with money to spend, looking to expand, it's sort of crossing things off the list and then stops at Memphis and says, there might be something here.
Right. It goes back to the thing, you know, people have said Memphis is open for business after a lot of years of not being able to get big ticket companies, corporations, manufacturing particularly to come here. But at the same time, there's always sort of a dark side to these incentive packages in that the companies tend to use them to pit cities against each other, you know, and that's part. So Kruger has gotten the tax freeze. Correct me if I'm wrong. But they're still weighing their options, which is code for, well, we're going to see what some other cities put forward. We like what you're offering, but let us make sure we're not getting a better offer down the road.
That's exactly right. And the vice president from Kruger, who was here this week, told me that very thing. They're going to sort of stack it all up, see who comes out best. One loss is another area's gain.
And this, we go back for a second to the budget, Amos. I mean, the big package, the $45 million sticker price, which really stands out on the whole Kruger incentive package, the unions, the city union leader had something to say about that. Tell us a little
every bit. In meetings, the last few council public meetings, and then yesterday, the administrator of the local AFSCME union just blasted away at the tax incentives, and basically implying that the city's having to take on these austerity measures because they're foregoing tax revenue. But that kind of avoids the issue that they are paying taxes on the
Kruger
property.
Is, yeah.
Yes, it's just at a decreased level, and they're also employing a lot of people who live in Memphis and spend money here and all of that. And it kind of ignores the reality of economic competition. If we say we're not going to do this, hundreds of other cities across the country will say, fine, we're going to do it, and we'll take your business.
Well, Morton, it's talked about that in the context of the Mitsubishi plan and the electronics plan. I think on the show he talked about, look, that's just the way the game is played, and if you're going to get these companies, you're going to put these incentives out.
Well, and in our case, it's even more acute because we're just across the state line from Mississippi, whose pilot program and qualifications basically date back to the 1980s when there really weren't any matrices or anything that gave you a cost-benefit ratio or how much you get in terms of tax base for what you forgive on the tax
base. And there was a wave of companies relocating down there in Mississippi because of those things.
I was just going to say, the Wharton, we can't stress enough how intense these city mayors, the chamber officials are in this thing. Just real quick, I'd mention the Industrial Development Board meeting this week was held. They moved from their normal quarters up to Mayor Wharton's seventh floor conference room. He was there at the head of the table. That sends a message. The last regular meeting of the Industrial Development Board, there was a manufacturer there who got an incentive, who was talking about just how great it was, that the intense the mayors were involved. He said, like, the night before the day before the meeting, both mayors were at the factory, all the workers snapping cell phone pictures, and just felt really that we must be important if they're here.
Right, and that's a big change from what people said in, honestly, the Harrington administration, where the administration was absent and there was no engagement from city leaders.
And unreliable.
Unreliable. We leave it there and move on to some sad news this week, that J.O. Patterson, an influential church leader, a city leader, an elected official, passed away this week. Les couldn't be here, but we do have a story he did. Let's go to that.
If not for the times, the collaboration of a minister, a businessman, and an attorney might not have taken on much historical significance. But thrust into the backdrop of the most tumultuous era in Memphis, the iconic 1968 sanitation workers' strike, three African-American men, relative strangers to each other, melded their individual talents to put the city on the right side of history.
We bring three different perspectives, three different characteristics, three different lives, and three different ideals.
We were advocates for the workers, and each in our own way were trying to advance the cause and bring more equality and justice to the sanitation workers.
With the death of their former colleague J.O. Patterson Jr. on Saturday, Fred L. Davis and Reverend James Netter shared their memories on Monday about being the first black members of the original Memphis City Council. Davis reflects, until the sanitation workers' strike, race relations in the Bluff City, while not perfect, had quietly enjoyed some modest gains, which had staved off violent demonstrations. However, with the election of the first blacks to the council, expectations among their constituents rose to new and often unrealistic heights. The city's stall tactics during the strike only served to inflame their frustrations toward Davis, Patterson, and Netters.
In the black community, there was a thinking that we were going to make everything much better for blacks only. And they feel that you are almost a sellout, a traitor. And many times we had to fight that kind of ideal.
These men have fought for this country. These men have died for this country. And all they're asking for is a little bit of self-respect.
It's been moved.
If I say, if I insult you, brothers, then I will go to heaven insulting you.
I was probably more volatile, a little bit more short patient.
Don't force me to not represent you well in this position here now.
J.O. was more articulate. He could turn a phrase better than the other two could.
The city has been saying the same thing for the past 7 weeks, and I predict that at the end of next 7 weeks, the city's position will remain the same, and that this strike will still be going on.
The assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King spurred sides to reach a settlement only days later, even as the council themselves were on the verge of working out a settlement before then. The three racial pioneers of the council, including Patterson, eventually went their separate ways, separate paths, but equal in admiration for the other.
We ended up in the same seminary together. And I was able to encourage him, and he was able to encourage me, so we shared many wonderful moments together.
I think he had a continuous interest in using his talents for the uplifting of the whole community, and in particular the African-American community.
So, Bill, get your thoughts on this. I mean, he certainly captured, I mean, that video that Les had there, the historical footage is just, you know, it's a whole different time in Memphis politics, and J.L. Patterson represented so much about that time. Mm-hmm.
In politics, much of success or failure in politics is due to timing. And in the case of that council, you consider that they took office in January of 1968. The strike began in February of 1968, and Dr. King was assassinated in April of 1968. The other aspect to the timing is, of course, J.L. Patterson was the city's first African-American mayor. He was mayor for 20 days when Wyeth Chandler resigned in 1982 because Patterson was chairman of the council. He ran in the special election that followed and actually won. He finished first, Dick Hackett finished second, but neither of them got a majority of the vote. which was required. So the election went to a runoff, and Hackett won and became mayor. The 1982 special election was the textbook case in 1991 in federal court for eliminating the runoff provision, which made the victory of Willie Herenton in the 91 election possible.
Because the theory was that without that runoff provision, or that runoff provision was going to prevent a black African-American candidate from ever winning in that era.
Right. It was more than a theory. The judge in the case, Jerome Turner, actually ruled that clearly the intent of that provision was to prevent a black from ever winning citywide office.
It's interesting to watch the video. And, you know, I mean, 68 is the year I was born, and I'm not young anymore. I mean, I'm 40-something years old. And it is so, politics here have changed a lot. There's still race, obviously, a big issue in local politics. But you've got Patterson passing away. You've got the Ford machine, which really came after J.O. Patterson, in part, as you were telling me in your article about J.O. Patterson, Ford winning the congressional seat that J.O. Patterson couldn't win, and the rise of the Ford machine. Mm-hmm. And you've really, you know, you've got Herenton off the stage. You've got a whole lot of African-American leaders who came out of that civil rights struggle, who really felt they had something to prove when they were running for office, that things have changed a great deal, mm-hmm. it seems to me.
Yeah, the what was happening in the 1960s, and Reverend Netters and Mr. Davis are absolutely right, that there were very high expectations despite the vote count. There were three black members on a 13-member city council. And that was considered progress at a time in a city where African Americans were 40% of the population. But what happened was that coalition of black leaders put aside their differences at times to build coalitions as the numbers in the population began going up, which everybody knew would happen.
All right. Well, we leave it there and move on to actually the suburbs. And we've spent a lot of time in the last few weeks, last couple of months, talking about city and county budgets. But the municipalities in the outside Memphis have all passed budgets in recent weeks, and in some cases with tax increases. We'll start maybe with Collierville, Bill, and what they passed and what that says about the changing dynamics in the suburbs, which in many ways bill themselves as low tax alternatives to the city of Memphis.
Not only low tax alternatives, but as having a markedly different philosophy toward debt than the city of Memphis and Shelby County government do. Collierville was the smaller of the two tax increases. Germantown's mayor and board of aldermen passed a 25-cent tax hike. Pretty substantial for these smaller communities. You also consider the Memphis tax hike, which the council is qualifying by saying it's not a raise in the tax rate, but that was 18 cents
right.
for the city of Memphis.
Right.
And what this indicates is that if these municipalities hope to follow through and start their own school systems in the wake of school consolidation between Memphis and Shelby County, that's going to be a much tougher decision if they go down that
right.
road.
Right, and without getting into all the complications of that, but the option on the table with this whole school consolidation situation is that they could form their own school districts at the end of this long process. But the costs associated with that are huge. I mean, Amos, talk a little bit about that. I mean, if you've got taxes that are half the price, half the rate of Memphis right now, in give or take, in Collierville and in Germantown, and you're going to then fund a school system, we're talking about massive tax increases, not
right.
in
you're,
the pennies.
You're talking about tens and tens and tens of millions of dollars, and maybe $100 million
right.
dollars or more. You'd have to get the facilities. You'd probably be forced to buy them from Shelby County Schools. Then you have to staff it. You have
right.
to provide benefits to the staff.
You have to operate it.
I mean, you are talking about...
It'll be an interesting fight because, again, those cities have billed themselves as low tax, different kind of approach than the Memphis City government. But they've also high schools. They've come out here for the schools.
That's exactly... They also tout their school system.
Right.
The majority of Shelby Countyans are in Memphis, so Memphians are essentially, you know, funding the majority of the Shelby County school
which folks
system.
In the county would disagree with. They
right.
would do different math on that.
But it's a massive undertaking that none of those governments are going to take lightly. I mean, that will take a lot of studying, a lot of public discussion.
And Andy, what drives these tax increases in part, or what drives the problems, I should say, not the tax increases, the problems in the budgets, come back to housing, something we write about a lot, you've covered a lot, the tax base and the trouble with the tax base, because all these cities, Memphis, Collierville, Germantown, are driven by property tax revenue. And those suburbs, which were booming for so many years, they too, the growth there, the construction there, has stagnated.
And it almost stopped completely is a better word in some areas. Economists like to say the property tax is an inelastic source of revenue because there's only so far you could stretch it. And there's just so many embedded limitations in these places, like Germantown being completely hemmed in. They can't really sort of organically expand the tax base as much as they might like to. And the other thing to keep in mind is when the taxes are already so low, the least little increase just sends a massive reverberation and leads to all these kind of discussions like this. As I say, it really speaks to kind of the embedded limitations in the suburbs. Great place to live, all these wonderful things, but somebody's going to pay for it.
And we talk for a second about the funding the schools. I want to go, Bill, to a piece you did last week on looking at Krenner Cash and the past year of reforms he's put in place and looking ahead at the next year. We've spent so much time talking about the consolidation fight that sometimes you lose track of the fact that there's been a reform agenda and a whole lot of school reforms have been put in place that Krenner Cash is trying to put in place, Krenner Cash, the superintendent of city schools. Talk a little about where those reforms stand separate from the whole consolidation fight and legal battle.
Well, I talked with him. It was kind of an end of the school year, into the summer interview. And he said right off the top that this was a pretty rocky year for the reform efforts, but he feels like it was ultimately a really good year for the reform efforts. They're about to get into considering how to remodel the teacher compensation package to have in it some kind of merit pay or pay for performance and incentives for young teachers to come into the school system and add some new blood to the teaching core of the school system. He felt very good about that, but he obviously knew he had been through the mill this past year with consolidation being this enormous shift of the spotlight away from the reform efforts that he had basically come to town to champion over the last 3 years.
Where do things stand with, we talked about teacher incentives and getting new teachers in, Teach for America is going to have a big presence in the mm-hmm. city schools next year. I remember at some point in the last year, before the whole legal fight blew up, there was talk of closing schools finally. And that this going back to the whole idea that the city school system, from a certain point of view, has too many buildings that are half full, less than half full. There's a lot of costs associated, inefficiencies, and a sense, a lack of energy when you've got a mm-hmm. half full school. It's kind of a semi-ghost town. Where does it stand? There were 30 to 40 schools on a potential list of closures.
On a very tentative list as well. The plan for school modifications, as they were called, or closings, was a casualty of some of the turmoil that we saw during the past school year. Cash actually delayed that and said, I'm not even going to try to discuss that at this time. We'll talk about it later. He also emphasized that the number that probably would have been closed and that he might come back with later will not be anywhere near that 30 number.
And do you think that will be back on the agenda this year, closing schools? Or is the legal fight just drowning out the energy for something like that?
I think that school closings are always the most emotional thing a school superintendent or school okay. board can do. So I think he'll wait to see the dust kind of clear from the school's consolidation.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll leave it there. Our last topic is the summer blockbuster movie season.
Is.
And you, Andy, did a story, an interesting story on Malco, the obviously dominant movie theater chain in the area, upgrading all its theaters, going digital, more 3D options. Tell us a little bit more about what people in Memphis are going to see if and when they go to the movies this summer.
It's an interesting reinvention story. And in many ways, Malco's in the catbird seat with something like Blockbuster just completely gone from Memphis. As you said, what's going on is Malco's in the process, locally owned and operated company, in the process of switching their more than 300 screens to an all-digital format. It does a number of things. It allows them to sort of download movies directly to the theater as opposed to waiting on shipments of canisters or the strips of film. Let's them have more 3D options, and not just movies. You can sort of go on the Malka website and see they're going to be broadcasting plays in the near future and Metropolitan Opera performances.
Oh, really? Will they do live ones from or taped ones from?
Some live, some taped of these things. But this digital format lets them just download all this straight to the theater. We mentioned 3D. Malka's announced a promotion this summer. You know, people sometimes complain about this, and it's said a lot about Hollywood. But the 3D films are a profit center for Hollywood, and for this summer, Malka is adding only a $1 additional charge to the price of a regular ticket for a 3D ticket, as opposed to before. $2 and $3 extra, things like that.
All this is interesting too, because you know, not that I follow this that closely, but I do like movies. Mm. You know, people said that the movie industry was dead. That you know, everyone has their flat screen TVs at home. You know, the home theater. You can get Netflix. You can download movies onto your iPhone or onto your computer. And yet, here's this investment in a really weak economy in these theaters. It's interesting.
But I'm going to go this weekend with my daughter, and we're going to see Cars 2. Hi, Bridie. so we'll be there. I mean, I'll be partaking in this effort, and I might go see two movies. It's not, it's especially during the summertime. It's so hot, and going to a movie can be relatively inexpensive, if you don't buy the popcorn and Cokes and all of that. You go and have, a really good time and cool off for a couple
hours. And I guess that's what they're after, is it just offering this as a destination, as not just watching a movie, because you can always just watch the movie at home, but something where it's more of an event to go and there's more.
These different things, the exhibitor business, they're limited to what Hollywood gives them, so that's why they're doing all these extra things. And they sort of have this theme of everybody has a kitchen, but we also go out to eat.
All right. Well, we will leave it there. Thank you. Good night. Thanks for joining us. Please go to WKNO for more information. Thanks. Good night.